Sexual harassment and discrimination affect women in the workplace every day. Knowing the boundaries is important, as is knowing what to do about it if you are the target. Elizabeth Broderick is Australia's Sexual Discrimination Commissioner, and she joins us now on the panel. Elizabeth, thank you for joining us.
Welcome.
Thank you.
What is the hard line when it comes to sexual discrimination in the workplace? Or is there
one? What is the line?
Yeah, and particularly sexual harassment. It's really, I mean, when you look at it, it's unwelcome conduct of a sexual nature, so it has to not be welcome, which intimidates, offends or humiliates. So it can be things like even a sexualised email, a sexualised video. It can be unwelcome hugging, kissing, cornering. It can be invasive questions about your personal life. Just for example, you know, someone comes in on a Monday and they say, "Did you have a great weekend? Did you get any?" Now, to have say, "Did you have a great weekend?" That's fine, but you're crossing the line when you say, "Did you get any?" If that person feels offended, humiliated, or intimidated, and it's reasonable for them to feel that way.
That's the interesting thing, isn't it? Because there are plenty of friends in the workplace. I know countless female friends of mine who come in, and we talk about that very freely and openly. Yeah. But it's very much in the eye of the beholder, isn't it? So often you don't know where the line is until you've already crossed it. Is that a problem?
You're right. And, you know, amongst friends, there's a particular dynamic happening, you know, and a more casual conversation. I suppose for workplaces, we have to remember that we are in a workplace, and things that might be funny between, say, Joe, you and I, are not necessarily funny to a woman that's listening in. So I think my advice to people is, if in doubt, don't do it.
But it's very difficult for a woman to complain about this type of thing.
Yes.
How does she deal with it?
You're absolutely spot on that, because what we've seen is when women step up and say something, often they become ostracised, they start to sit outside the group. So, you know, of course, women can step up either in their own organisations, and most good organisations now are saying, look, this is so not part of our culture, sexual harassment. We've got a zero tolerance. And that makes it easier for women to step up. But I always say to women, and, you know, we've all got our stories, I'm sure we have sitting here, we often talk to other women about it, our friends, and we work out different solutions that way. And just to give you one example of that, I had a friend recently who was having problems at work. She wasn't the only target. There were other women, you know, "Oh, can you come and bend over the photocopier?" That kind of nice remark. And I said to her, "You've got to step up and say something about it." "No, I can't." She said, "I need this job. I need the money. I'm travelling overseas."
Exactly right.
So what did we do? Got a copy of my brochure. I just happened to have a whole lot at home that day. I stapled my cards around. I said, "Here, put this on his desk. And when he comes out tomorrow and, you know, says, 'Who put this on my desk?' Say, 'Oh, look, actually, I did. My friend's a sex discrimination commissioner.'" She did that. The whole behaviour shut down very, very quickly. I'm not necessarily recommending that as a strategy, although I do have a lot of brochures at work. But what I do say is that when a bystander steps up and actually just takes a small part of action to draw that to a person's attention, what we know from research is that the behaviour can shut down very, very quickly.
But they're interesting strategies then. Yeah. So some women might not feel comfortable verbally approaching someone. You might have to get someone else involved, or, as you said, put the brochures on the desk. I was also interested, just chatting to you just then, Elizabeth, was saying that assumably, like, men are more the perpetrators of sexual harassment, but, like, there's not too many women who are who are the discriminators, I guess. It's nearly all men.
It is mainly men. I think the stats around about 92-95% of sexual harassment.
It's a really big stat.
It's really big. And I should say that it's not just women that are targets. It's often other men. So for the first time in our research, just last, 2 years ago now, we found that 21% of all harassment was men on men, which is fascinating.
Oh, wow.
It's a growing group. And we
gay men or straight men?
No, so it wasn't necessarily the gay man who was a target, but what we did find was it's the man who isn't part of a dominant macho culture in the environment. So he's the man that likes maybe books and music when the dominant culture is, "Oh, we blokes like sport."
Footy. Yeah,
footy. Mm. So he's sitting a bit outside the picture. And, you know, I think it's an even more deeply hidden issue. What we do know is that an organisation that allows sexual harassment of women will often, you'll find pockets of sexual harassment of men, and that goes for sexual assault as well in the areas that I look at.
Yeah, it's about creating boundaries and speaking up. You don't need to sort of take... Just a gentle, "I'm not comfortable," might be enough to shut it down and just to reaffirm those boundaries. Elizabeth, thank you very much for coming in. It's such a fraught subject. It's good to have your expertise on the panel.